What's going on, guys? Billy here, and today we're going to be covering a very long overdue video topic. It's a battle of two titans in the folding drone market. We're going to be comparing the DJI Mavic 2 Pro to the Autel Evo 2 Pro. Both of these drones sitting in front of me are not spring chickens. They've sat at the top as the go-to option for serious professionals that need a more portable platform when they're capturing their aerial images on the go. And they're also a great option for the weekend warrior that might only fly a couple of times a week or a couple of times a month and just wants the best of the best that the foldable drone market offers. Now, even though it might be hard to believe, the DJI Mavic 2 Pro came out 919 days ago. That is a little over 2.5 years ago. I still remember it like it was yesterday, going up to New York in Brooklyn there for the event with Ken. That was a ton of fun. As for the Evo 2 Pro here, it's definitely the newer drone, being released only 417 days ago from the date of uploading this video, so it's been a little over a year. In fact, it was initially debuted at CES 2020, but they didn't start shipping the drone until like 3 or 4 months after the show ended, which is typical Autel fashion. But nonetheless, we've got both of these drones. They are still at the top of the foldable drone market, and I actually think that procrastinating and waiting to do this video until about a year after was a good thing, because if I did this initial comparison as soon as the Evo 2 Pro came out, I would have just said the Evo 2 Pro was the best because it was the brand new drone. But now I've gotten to live with both of these drones. I know their pros and cons, their strengths and their weaknesses, so I don't think that there's any better time than now in 2021 to figure out which one of these drones is the best. To get into things here, there are 7 topics that I want to cover in regards to the comparison of these two drones, and of course there will be timestamps included down in the description for you to skip around to hear what is most important to you. So to get things started, I want to throw up the general specs of both of these drones side by side so that we can get a better understanding of what we can expect from each of these platforms. You'll see that the comparison is just ever so close in each of these categories, which makes my job comparing them really difficult. Now, if price matters to you, then right off of the bat, you might be leaning towards the Mavic 2 Pro, but if you like to buy your tech purely off of the spec sheet, then you might be in favor of the Evo 2 Pro with its slight edge. Regardless of what current position you're in, let's get things going here so that I can hopefully help you make up your mind as to which drone is right for you. One of the most important things to consider when it comes to choosing which drone you want to buy is the transmission system that's used to send the signal to and from the remote controller and the drone itself. And I've been talking about this for years on my channel, but unfortunately, most of the marketing buzz and marketing hype is surrounded around the camera, the design of the drone, other cool features of the drone, or the flight time, when in reality, that transmission system is incredibly important. And I've got to give Autel some props because the transmission system in the Evo 2 holds up really nicely in everyday flying. I've flown some drones on the channel like the Skydio 2, the PowerEgg X drone, the Parrot Anafi, all of which have one thing in common: they have terrible transmission systems. I mean, what's a drone with cool features, great flight time, and a great camera if it can't fly more than 1,000 feet away? And quite frankly, I'm not all that worried about the maximum distance I can fly with my drone, but I'm worried about that signal fidelity. I'm worried about how much breakup I'm gonna receive when I fly my drone. I want a clear signal, and luckily both the Mavic 2 Pro and Evo 2 Pro hold up phenomenally at most distances, but I've gotta give the edge to the Mavic 2 Pro and its OcuSync 2.0 transmission system. DJI's marketing team has done a great job at naming their transmission system, right? It starts all the way back with the Lightbridge 1 in the Phantom and in the Inspire, and now we've got OcuSync 2. And the reason that naming these transmission systems is so great is because it feels like we've grown with these drones. We've been able to keep better track of the upgrades from generation to generation of drone, whereas with the Evo 2, it's just like, yeah, we've got a transmission system and you can fly 9 kilometers, 5.5 miles, right? So not only is the marketing better in DJI's transmission system, but it also is just the best transmission system right now in a drone that you can buy, right? So not only is the range like 1 kilometer further, it's 10 kilometers with the Mavic 2 Pro opposed to 9 kilometers in the Evo 2 Pro, but it's also got a dual frequency option. So you can operate over 2.4 or 5.8 gigahertz here with the Mavic 2 Pro, whereas the Evo 2 Pro only has a single band, right? It's only 2.4 gigahertz. And what's great about the Mavic 2 Pro is you can leave it on auto and let the drone choose the best signal for you. There's no work required on your part. This overall gives you a better experience in the Mavic 2 Pro. The slightest lag, drop in frames, or black screen can ruin the immersion of the experience of flying and can cost you that important shot that you're trying to get. As you can see in the screen recording, I'm able to comfortably fly close to a mile away with a perfect signal beaming back to my Mavic 2 Pro. This gives me the best possible experience flying, again, not having to deal with any interruptions. Now, because the camera in both of these drones is probably the reason why you even want to buy a drone in the first place, I figured I couldn't go any further without mentioning them. Now, this category right here is where we really begin to see the newness of the Evo 2 Pro shine. I mean, 2.5 years really does make a difference when it comes to camera technology. And while the specs are neck and neck, I mean, I would say that this right here is an even tighter comparison than the airframe, the actual drone itself. It's able to edge the Mavic 2 Pro out in the video department with more resolution and frame rate options. Photographs, on the other hand, are nearly the same with an identical sensor size and megapixel count. This is further proven by the nearly identical photos I was able to capture with both of these drones. I did my best to line up the same exact shot, and I was really surprised at how similar the photos looked. Now, these are untouched, right? They're raw photographs that I'm cycling through here, so you can push them around pretty hard. You're able to adjust the exposure, you can change the colors and the white balance. So if you guys really want to, I've put the raw photos available for download in the description so that you can edit them for yourselves, put them next to each other, and figure out which you prefer. Now, quite frankly, even though the Mavic 2 Pro has that Hasselblad badge on the front, I just can't give a win to either drone in this category. I would say that if your goal is to primarily shoot photographs with your drone and you're trying to decide between the Mavic 2 Pro and Evo 2 Pro, then you should look at the other categories like the airframe to figure out which drone better suits your needs. Now, to sort of switch gears here, the video department is where things become a little bit messy because each of these drones have cameras that offer certain features and a certain experience that the other camera just doesn't. Like, when I sit down and look at comparison clips between the Mavic 2 Pro and the Evo 2 Pro, I actually notice a difference in the footage that both of these drones produce. It's not like the photos that are almost exactly identical. Both are really sharp with clarity in favor of the Evo 2 Pro shooting a higher resolution 6K video, but I find the actual image coming from the Mavic 2 Pro is a lot more pleasing. It looks more punchy with higher contrast, and the colors feel more natural shooting in this normal color profile to what I was actually seeing there as I flew with my own eyes. Now, there's also another side to flying your drone and getting great video, and that is the actual control of the drone. We're going to touch on the remote here in a few minutes, so I'm going to get deeper into it, but the flight software of the Mavic 2 Pro is just flat out better than the Evo 2 Pro, which allows you to get those smooth, precise shots. For example, this shot flying up and over the trees to reveal Manyunk here in Philly is an absolute breeze with the Mavic 2 Pro. I don't even have to think about it. The gimbal is so smooth, tilting down as the drone effortlessly flies up, but trying to replicate this same shot with the Evo 2 Pro goes pretty well until it's time to tilt that gimbal downwards. It's just really choppy, it moves too fast, and ultimately it makes this shot unpredictable. Now, like I said, I am going to be touching on the remote controllers a little bit later in the video. In fact, it's the next category that we're going to be touching on here after the camera, but I want to interject in the middle of this video section because I just can't downplay how important control is when you're shooting video, right? The control of your drone. You want something that's precise, something that's smooth, something that is overall reliable and inspires confidence. All of those things, those four things perfectly describe the Mavic 2 Pro. It is a reliable workhorse, but unfortunately, they do not describe the Autel Evo 2 Pro. When I'm flying my Mavic 2 Pro, I can get the shot that I want on the very first time, probably 99% of the time. It is smooth, it is precise as a rock, if that makes sense, and it goes exactly where I want it to go every single time. But the Evo 2 Pro, on the other hand, sometimes has a mind of its own. The controls kind of feel mushy, the gimbal wheel doesn't have a whole lot of range of motion, it's also a little bit high on the remote controller, so control is huge when it comes to shooting video, and the Mavic 2 Pro just has much better control over the Evo 2 Pro. Now, getting back on track here, if you want to take full advantage of shooting video with these drones, you'll probably want to check out their log profiles, which I think evens the playing field out a little bit. Both, of course, are capturing these videos in 10-bit color, so now I have more flexibility with the Evo 2 Pro footage to grade it, work on it in post, and restore those accurate colors. The Mavic 2 Pro, on the other hand, feels easier to color grade in post, and it still has that punchy feel over the Evo's footage. Now, where the Mavic 2 Pro really stands out is in its automated flight features that ultimately make shooting video easier, and they've put years of time, effort, research, and development into making these better and ultimately making them very usable, right? So, two that come come to mind are quick shots. So you can actually put the drone out there, press a button, and it performs this really cool action to give you a great shot without having to do anything. You just stand there and let the drone do all the work. Now, something that I find to be a little bit cooler are hyperlapses. And admittedly, I haven't really used that feature. Now, I'm someone that you could probably call old fashioned. I like shooting photos and videos and creating longer form content, but hyperlapses look awesome. And my buddy, Cody McClintock, that I fly with all the time here in Philadelphia, has shot a ton of great hyperlapses. So I've got to give a big thanks to him for letting me use some of his content here in my video to show you guys how cool these hyperlapses are. If you guys want to check out some of his content, I'm going to put a link down in the description to his Instagram. Be sure to go over there and give him some love and tell him that I sent you over there. But at the end of the day, this hyperlapse mode is wicked cool. And unfortunately, the Evo 2 Pro just doesn't have it. So moving on here, finally, I want to touch on the remote controllers that come with these drones. And much like the transmission system, I find this to be one of the most important factors that go into deciding which drone you want to purchase. Because at the end of the day, this is the thing you interact with the most when you're flying your drone. Now, both DJI and Autel have used the same general design from the previous version of each of these drones. The Mavic 2 Pro's remote does feature some welcome changes like removable sticks, the ability to flip the drone into tripod mode using the flight mode switch on the side of the remote. And also we've got this change to a grayish color from the black finish on the original Mavic Pro remote. Autel, on the other hand, kept the same exact remote between the Evo 1 and Evo 2. They literally didn't change a single thing. This is such a pain point for me because the Evo 2 Pro is such a great drone with great specs, but it is seriously held back by all the design flaws of this remote controller, and ultimately it's held back by the control of the drone, right? It just doesn't have as good a flight software as the Mavic 2 Pro. Now, to be a little bit more specific about why I'm not a huge fan of this remote controller, the weight feels unevenly distributed with the mobile device hanging out at the top on this flimsy phone holder. There's no clever cable routing solution like in the Mavic's remote. I accidentally push the custom buttons all of the time on the back. I mean, it's just the way that my fingers rest on the back. It's a huge pain. And also, just the general ergonomics feel off. It doesn't feel like a comfortable remote to use for longer flight sessions. Now, the biggest crime of them all is that the Evo 2 Pro's remote controller doesn't have a flight mode switch. So if you want to go into that faster, ludicrous speed, you've got to dig through the menu settings, click on ludicrous mode, make sure you're in the highest 45 mile an hour top speed, and then you can close out and fly. It is such a hassle. Now, not everything that I have to say about the Evo 2's remote controller is bad. I do have to give Autel some props. Get it? Props. I've got to give them some credit where credit is due because the Evo 2's remote does offer some good features. So for one, the built-in color screen is a nice touch and you can use it to actually fly the drone if you really wanted to. So that's a good backup option in case your phone dies or if you're just getting way too many notifications. And also having that mobile device up above the controls might feel a little bit more comfortable to some people. But again, to me personally, it feels a little bit too top heavy. Now transitioning over to the Mavic 2 Pro's remote controller. Personally, I think that the built-in LCD screen gets the job done perfectly fine, showing all of your important information at a quick glance. And all of it is very easy to read on that black backdrop. Now, I also really like the way that the mobile device fits in underneath of the controls, making the remote feel solid with a nice even weight distribution, making this a much more comfortable experience for me during longer flight sessions. You can tell that they put a lot of thought into their remotes by looking at the newer style Mavic remote, how there is still a nice even feel to the weight of the remote without any weird gaps like what came on the handles of that Evo remote controller. Okay, so I have definitely overextended the amount of time that I can discuss remote controllers in this video, but to kind of bring things full circle here, the Mavic 2 Pro has got a winning formula. It's got a very precise flying drone with great flight software, and it's also got a great precise remote controller with nice stick movements, a nice gimbal wheel in the back. It's precise across the board, but unfortunately, I can't say the same thing for the Evo 2 Pro. It's got a so-so remote controller. I wouldn't go as far as saying it's terrible, but it's just so-so, and the flight software also isn't as good as what comes on the Mavic 2 Pro, so you're gonna get screwed from one end or the other when you're trying to shoot that smooth, precise video. Your controller is going to fail you or the flight software is going to fail you, and you're gonna have to try multiple times to get that shot. So I'm kind of trying to bring things full circle here. I've got all the faith in the world. The Mavic 2 Pro is gonna get the job done and it's gonna go exactly where I want it to because the remote controller is nice and precise. But again, I can't really say the same thing about the Evo 2 Pro. Now, I feel like I've gotta mention this here and then we'll be done about remote controllers. You can get DJI's smart controller to fly with the Mavic 2 Pro. It comes with an integrated screen. I did a full review review video, you can go ahead and check out the link up in the corner to watch that video and learn more about this remote controller. I've heard some murmurs about an Autel smart controller, but nothing is official yet. So if they do end up coming out with one, that could be cool, a nice competitor to DJI's smart controller. But for now, all we've got is a smart controller, and okay, we're done with remote controllers. So despite sharing very similar airframe styles, the list of differences grows very quickly when we put these two drones side by side. The Evo 2 in general is a little bit bulkier than the Mavic 2 Pro, with this hump that sticks out at the top, the butter knife style props that dig in your hands when you grab the drone, front legs that really extend down from the drone and seem to get caught on everything in my bag, and the lines are a little bit more curvy than the more aggressive styled straight edges on the Mavic 2 Pro. Now with all of that extra room in the Evo though, we have got a full suite of sensors around the entire drone with a dual set of obstacle avoidance sensors facing in every single direction. This adds up to a total of 12 sensors for true omnidirectional obstacle avoidance when flying in that normal flight mode, whereas with the Mavic 2 Pro, it only sees obstacles during normal flight in the front, back, and on the bottom. The sides of the drone only feature one obstacle avoidance sensor in each direction and an infrared sensor on the top of the drone. Now, I should note that the Mavic 2 Pro does have true omnidirectional obstacle avoidance, but only in certain flight modes. So for example, in tripod mode, when the drone isn't moving as fast and when it doesn't pitch as far to move, the side and the top sensor do work, giving it that true omnidirectional obstacle avoidance. But it is comforting knowing that with the Evo 2 Pro, even when you're flying at those faster normal speeds that a lot of people typically do, you are covered in every single direction. And that's why this drone is so big, because it's got all of those sensors. Now these drones do have a couple of other things in common. They've got 8 gigabytes inside of internal memory to store video on the go and photos on the go. And also they have got these LEDs on the bottom of the drone, so you can actually land in lower light and the drone can see what it's landing on. So that's a great feature that both of these drones have. The final benefit to having a drone that is just a tad bigger is that you can fit a larger battery. So the 7,100 milliamp hour battery pack gives the Evo 2 an advertised flight time of 40 minutes on the dot. This is roughly 25% longer than the Mavic 2 Pro's advertised flight time of 31 minutes. So for these higher level comparison videos, where I'm throwing around a ton of numbers and going over a ton of information and facts, I write everything down in my notes app and then I refer back to it here as I go along and talk to you guys through the camera. And I've got this entire piece written down about how the Mavic 2 Pro is more efficient than the Evo 2 Pro, and I feel like it just doesn't really matter at this point in time. At the end of the day, what's really important is flight time. The more time you're up in the air, the better. The Evo 2 Pro gives you 40 minutes of flight time. The Mavic 2 Pro gives you 31 minutes of flight time. So obviously, if you're somebody that really craves being in the air for as long as possible, you might look at the Evo 2 Pro as the better drone. But also remember that the Evo 2 Pro has a battery that is relatively twice the size of the Mavic 2 Pro in terms of capacity, but it doesn't give you double the amount of flight time. We don't go from 31 minutes to 62 minutes because that extra weight is going to significantly weigh down the drone and eat into the flight time. So the Evo 2 Pro is pretty heavy. It's heavier than the Mavic 2 Pro. And also the batteries do cost more for the Evo 2 Pro. So they cost $219 for the Evo 2 Pro compared to $149 for the Mavic 2 Pro. And that's pretty expensive. I mean, usually I carry like 5 batteries for a drone. So you do 219 times an extra 4 batteries. That's $876 for new batteries for the Evo 2 Pro. So it's something to kind of consider if you're going to be buying new batteries in the future. Just know that the Mavic 2 Pro's batteries are less expensive than the Evo 2 Pro's by like $70. All right, so final thoughts time, my final verdict on Mavic 2 Pro versus Evo 2 Pro. If I was going away on a trip right now, let's say to Iceland, and I could only bring one of these drones, I would choose the Mavic 2 Pro. And my reasoning behind this is because it's tried, it's trusted, it's been through hell and back, basically. It's reliable, it's smooth, it's precise. And I promise you, I'm not making my decision off of nostalgia because I've been using this drone for so long and I'm used to it. Because when the Evo 2 Pro came out, I was really excited for what it offered. It had a great airframe, great feature set. It had, great sensors, a great camera overall. But then once I got it, and once I flew it for about a week, on the daily, I thought to myself, okay, when can I go back to my Mavic 2 Pro? Because at the end of the day, the Mavic 2 Pro offers a much wider range and fuller feature set that's gonna get me the best aerial photos and videos possible out of both of these drones. You know, I really should have shown these clips earlier in this video because I probably could have just shown them to you and this could have been the comparison video and you would have easily made up your mind between Mavic 2 Pro and Evo 2 Pro. But with my Evo 2, when I was flying it up the Schuylkill River, it would nonstop kick to the left. I mean, it was like clockwork every single time. I'd fly in ludicrous mode, I'd get a nice head of steam going, and then the drone would just veer to the left and totally ruin my shot. This is what happens with the Evo 2. If it's not the controller that fails me, if it's not the gimbal that fails me, it's the drone that fails me. It just totally veers to the left. It bobs up and down. It gives me an unstable shot that just gives me unusable footage. This is the reason why I've been harping on reliability this entire time, because the Mavic 2 Pro does offer a more reliable package. There's so many little things that make the Mavic 2 Pro better than the Evo 2 Pro that I simply couldn't cover in this video. I mean, we covered the main things, the camera, the specs, the general design of the drone, the remote controller, the transmission system, right? All of these things are so important, but there's other little behind the scene things that I just can't mention in a video because there's too many to mention. The frequent firmware updates for the Mavic 2 Pro make it even better every single time. DJI is still supporting this as their flagship drone, so it's getting those frequent firmware updates as well as updates to the DJI Go app. I probably should have given a whole section on the application itself, the companion app, but the DJI Go app is leaps and bounds ahead of what Autel is offering with their Explorer application. So there's a lot of these little things that make the Mavic 2 Pro so much better, and it makes it a much more enjoyable experience that really, if I had to choose between both of these drones, it would be a no-brainer as to which I would choose, which is the Mavic 2 Pro, because at the end of the day, it comes down to one word: reliability. I'm gonna get the best footage and the best photos I can from this drone because it's reliable. But there's an elephant in the room, and I'm sure there's gonna be somebody commenting down in the comment section that I haven't mentioned it because they didn't watch the video all the way through, and it's geozones. It's DJI's safe system, it's their fly safe system, and I think that it's somewhat of a controversial topic because people are upset that DJI limits them to where they can fly with the red zones built into their application. But let me give you a quick example here. So I fly in Philadelphia. It's where I live. It's basically my playground. And if you refer to DJI's FlySafe database for this area, they've marked certain zones in red where you shouldn't be flying. So three examples of this are the Camden County Jail here in Jersey, right here in Old City where the Liberty Bell and Independence Hall are located, which is a national park, by the way. And of course, the area surrounding the Philadelphia International Airport. Now, if you look closely, you'll notice that in each of these examples, DJI has only blocked off the necessary areas that you really shouldn't be flying in. It properly covers the area of just the jail and just the national park without being too aggressive and blocking off the surrounding area a couple of blocks down. Even down at the airport, they have the red zone covering out to the property lines and a little bit further for the approach and landing patterns. That's it. I mean, really, do you even think that you should be flying here this close to the airport? Even if you wanted to, this is a zero altitude zone and you wouldn't even be able to apply for LANC. Now, I absolutely understand that everybody's situation is definitely going to be different. There's a lot of people that get frustrated because they've got like a closed, abandoned airport that is somehow marked in a no-fly zone and they live right next to it and they just want to fly their drone in their backyard, but they can't. And I think that DJI has done a really good job at cleaning up these fly-safe areas over the past couple of years, but at the end of the day, I see it as a safety feature. It's showing people who just buy their drone where they can and can't fly. I mean, when I first bought my drone from Best Buy back in 2016, I had no idea where I could and couldn't fly it. So having something like this built right into the drone is a great safety feature, and I don't think it's too overbearing, but there are going to be some people that want to buy the Evo 2, whether it's the 8K version or the Pro version, just because they don't lock down where you can and can't fly. And if you want to buy an inferior drone for that reason, be my guest. But at the end of the day, the Mavic 2 Pro is my pick for being reliable. Anyway, guys, hope you enjoyed the video. And as always, I'll talk to you later. Peace.